New tonight, the influencer in chief. The White House is pushing back against the idea that it is the president's 32-year-old senior advisor, Stephen Miller, who is running the show when it comes to the president's completely inconsistent stance on immigration. When asked if Stephen Miller has veto power over any immigration deal today, Sarah Sanders said this.
The only person I'm aware of with veto power in this country is the president.
Tries to laugh it off, but it is not a laughing matter. It's a serious question. You just heard that discussed by Senator Merkley and by Mark Preston. Out front now, Paul Begala, former White House counselor to President Clinton, and Steve Cortez, who is head of President Trump's Hispanic Council, or was, I'm sorry, during the campaign, and also our newest political commentator. So, Steve, welcome to CNN. Glad to have you.
Thank you.
All right, Paul.
Thank you for having me.
Good. And so, Paul, let me start with you, though. You just wrote an op-ed for CNN.com on this topic, just published. Sanders, you just heard her say, Stephen Miller is not running the show. Do you buy it?
No. We thought the show was going to be The Apprentice. It turns out to be Who's the Boss? Look, I worked for a president. I was honored to serve President Clinton in the White House. Every president has to defer on some issues. So say if this were agriculture policy, and our president is a real estate developer from Manhattan, he has an agriculture secretary, Sonny Perdue, I think it'd be wise for him to defer, frankly, to Secretary Perdue. But this is the president's signature issue, and on it he has said many times that he would sign legislation to regularize the Dreamer status, and yet now he has flip-flopped, according to Senator Lindsey Graham, who was in the room, because Stephen Miller, the staff, yanks it back. So this is we know who's running the show down there, and it's President Stephen Miller.
Steve?
Well, listen, I would say to that, Paul, as long as we're talking television shows, when you say President Stephen Miller, I would tell you that is as laughable and as fictional as the show Barney Miller. And I might be dating myself a little bit. You probably remember that.
That's a good
Aaron
show,
might be
yeah.
too young.
I'm thinking of a purple dinosaur.
To remember Barney Miller. But look, anyone who observes, which is everyone in America, who observes President Trump knows, whether it was from The Apprentice, candidate Trump, President Trump knows, this is not a man who easily cedes authority and control. And I happen to have the privilege of knowing him personally. So the idea that he would somehow give up control to a sort of second president or a pseudo president is, I think, honestly kind of laughable on its face. I think what's really going on here is the left realizes that they lost clearly in this showdown over the shutdown. And so what are they trying to do now? They're trying to create a boogeyman in Stephen Miller, somebody who is supposedly completely out of step with the American people. Except here's the problem. President Trump ran unambiguously on a program of controlling the border and reforming our immigration system as candidate. He was elected primarily probably on that basis, and now he's following through on it. So he may be out of step with the mainstream media. He might be out of step with a lot of the Senate,
all right,
but he's
so
not out of step
with America. Understand you all disagree on the power that he has. I will point out even Republicans like Lindsey Graham are saying Stephen Miller has that power. But let's just put that table, whether he has the power or not, for a second, because sometimes it's not reality, but it's perception that matters. Paul, Stephen sure. Miller is getting the same sort of headlines that upset the president so grievously when they apply to Steve Bannon. Okay, here's some of them. Mm-hmm. The Daily Beast, President Miller shutdown. Business Insider, some now referring to Miller as President Stephen Miller. Esquire, President John Kelly or co-president Stephen Miller. John Kelly, of course, the chief of staff. How damning are these headlines for Stephen Miller and John Kelly's future, Paul?
Well, I there's some reporting already that General Kelly's like looking for the exits, which I would not blame him. He's an American hero. I don't agree with him on issues, but he's an American hero and deserves our respect. Mr. Miller, I think slightly less of a hero, actually. He's a 32-year-old guy, worked on the Hill, that's fine. But what he has done, what's unprecedented, I never saw Steve Bannon overrule the president like this. The president sat down. We all saw it on national television. It was a remarkable meeting, right? For an hour, he sat in the cabinet room.
And the Tuesday meeting, yeah.
Senator Dianne Feinstein of California said to him, would you sign what she called a clean DACA bill, that is, allow the Dreamers to stay with nothing else attached, no strings attached. The president said, yes, let me read you, it's in my column on CNN.com, exactly what he said. He said, yes, and then move to phase two, which would be comprehensive immigration reform, but I think we need to do DACA first. That's the president speaking to a senator, making a deal until Steve Miller overruled it. I think it's almost certainly unprecedented
but Paul,
in the Trump White
on.
House.
The idea that Stephen Miller, who I happen to really respect, but the idea that he
that
is somehow
us, but
Geppetto,
okay.
that he's the puppeteer. Well, no, not just one of us. Actually, there's about 40 million of us who voted for President Trump.
No,
largely based
Steve
on
Miller.
The agenda
I'm not a Miller
that
fan.
Stephen Miller lay it out. In any case,
I don't like a staff guy over Stephen Miller, the president.
The idea that he is somehow this puppeteer, that he's Geppetto, and that the president is Pinocchio, all right, is just an absurdity.
That's a good analogy.
He's an important voice. He's an important voice among many important voices. And by the way, Steve Bannon, good friend of mine, not the president. He would be the first to say there are many voices within the White House, often very disparate voices, as there are within the Senate. There's one president. There's one indispensable man who has the mandate of the American people, who is changing this country, by the way, particularly when it comes to the economy, for the better in ways that I think people in Washington can't even think about.
Steve Miller not only is being credited by Democrats and Republicans with having the final word on this, whether you want to say overruled or convincing or whatever, I'm not going to weigh in on the politics of it. He is passionate about immigration. He actually is the only one who's come out and take questions on immigration from the press. So this is clearly his signature issue. Here he is in a combative exchange with our own Jim Acosta in the press briefing room.
Aren't you trying to change what it means to be an immigrant coming into this country if you're telling them you have to speak English? Can't people learn how to speak English when they get here?
Well, first of all, right now, it's a requirement that to be naturalized, you have to speak English.
Are we just going to bring in people from Great Britain and Australia?
Jim, actually, I have to honestly say, I am shocked at your statement that you think that only people from Great Britain and Australia would know English.
Sounds like you're trying to engineer the racial and ethnic flow of people into this country.
Jim, that is one of the most outrageous, insulting, ignorant, and foolish things you've ever said, and for you, that's still a really... The notion that you think that this is a racist bill is so wrong and so insulting.
Combative, to say the least, Paul.
Gosh, to say the least, in that sense, I do think he's reflecting the president. It's a tragic thing. The majority of Americans believe our president is a racist. In the polling, right, in the Quinnipiac poll, over 50% of Americans think he prefers white people to non-white people. Why? Because he said so. He was in that infamous meeting in the Oval Office. And he said, we need more immigrants from Norway and not from unflattering comment countries in Africa, the Caribbean, or Central America. That's just racist when you say you want more white immigrants and fewer brown immigrants. So in that sense, Mr. Miller is simply repeating the president's view, which is a tragically racist view.
You know what's actually racist? Is telling minorities, and I say this as an Hispanic, is telling minorities at election time, we value you and we value your vote, and then forgetting about them in between and allowing them to live
lives. We just shut down the government
often,
for them. What do you mean forget about them?
For Hispanic Americans? No, he didn't. He shut down the government, the Democrats shut down the government for illegal immigrants. And by the way, illegal immigrants have done tremendous harm to the economic prosperity of legal Hispanic Americans, of legal African Americans. So what the president is doing is saying America first, no matter your creed, no matter your color, your economic prosperity,
Norway
your security
first,
is going to be my first priority. And by the way, there's nothing racist about that. That's actually the opposite of racist. It's saying we're not here to exploit you. We're here to improve your lives. All right. And that's what President Trump has done. That's why the economy is accelerating. It's why optimism abounds in this country right now. And it's why we have a bright future, whatever your color is.
All right. Thank you both. You'll get the last word because Paul, you have the first. I appreciate both your time.
Thanks, Aaron.
And next,